10.5 come promesso, eccoci a dare il via. Io mi presento, sono Luca Besana, responsabile canale di SentinelOne. Con me sono contentissimo di avere praticamente tutto il team sud-europeo di Zimperium, giusto Mary? Siete al completo?
Esatto. Siamo completo, sì.
Ok,
Anzi, adesso.
e quindi rinnovo ancora il ringraziamento per il supporto che ci darete. Cosa vedremo oggi? Oggi abbiamo pensato per i partner SentinelOne un momento di approfondimento su Singularity Mobile, come sapete, la nuova offerta di protezione MTD, quindi Mobile Threat Defense, che abbiamo inserito in portafoglio, ovviamente soluzione che nasce in collaborazione con Zimperium. Purtroppo queste saranno le uniche parole con me e MD che sentirete in italiano oggi, perché lo speech sarà interamente in lingua inglese. Sentirete Gerd Nobles, che è il responsabile, anzi, lascio a Mehdi il piacere di presentare i suoi colleghi, perché non voglio fare gaffe e non voglio comunque togliere platea a chi se la merita tutta. Quindi, lato SentinelOne, io passo la palla, vi ringrazio molto, rimango collegato qualora ci fossero delle domande, però palla a voi Mehdi e ancora grazie mille del supporto.
Grazie a te Luca, grazie a tutti per la presenza. So che è molto difficile avere molta gente con tutto quello che si è da fare durante la settimana. Comunque, grazie per le 21 presenze. Allora, esatto, Luca, faccio le presentazioni. Allora, io sono Mehdi Bouzouba, sono rappresentante per il canale per Europa del Sud, perciò la vostra interface, l'extension di Luca per quello che avete bisogno, quello che riguarda la tecnologia mobile. Abbiamo con noi oggi i nostri esperti, Gerd Nobles, il nostro capo tribù EMEA, che è anche un esperto tecnico avanzato, che ci darà una visione, diciamo, abbastanza tecnica della presentazione per le persone che sono qua con noi. E in più abbiamo Marcos Regidor, Marcos è il nostro guru tecnico, esperto in tecnologia, che andrà a farvi anche una presentazione Zkit dell'Hacking Demo Online, che è un tool eccellente per far capire ai clienti finali dove sta il valore di detection. È una sessione molto tecnica, perciò vi chiederò gentilmente di fare le domande tecniche sul chat con Luca, Gert, Marcos e lo staff di Exclusive. Andremo così a fare le domande chiare, per così un po' chiarire tutto il tema tecnico sulla parte sia Singularity Mobile per le domande di funzionamento, ma anche sulla parte Zkit per poter usare correttamente nel futuro questo bellissimo tool. Ecco, c'è anche Alfonso Rimeno, il nostro capo, diciamo, della regione anche in Italia, è in ascolto. Insomma, siamo qua tutti presenti per darvi una bella sessione tecnica e mi raccomando, siamo aperti per domande anche dopo offline, dopo questa sessione. A posto così, Luca, possiamo iniziare. Switcho in inglese perché le mie persone sono anglofone, però io rimango qua in backplane se ci sono delle domande tecniche, se bisogna rispondere un po' in italiano per le persone che hanno bisogno. A posto così, Luca, iniziamo.
Assolutamente sì. So, let's move to English and thank you guys for your help today. And up to you, the scene is yours.
Perfect, Gert, the floor is yours. Let's start with the walkthrough and the technical presentation, please. I'm in the back plane for you if you need anything in Italian for translation or anything else. Okay, thank you so much, guys. Gert.
Thanks for the introduction, Mary. So what I would propose, if you have any questions during the presentation, let's make it interactive. Please raise them via the tool or just interrupt me, right? And you can even offer me in Italian. Mary would be more than happy to translate them for me. Perfect. So today we have a two-hour session on explaining Singularity Mobile. What you should get out of this session is that by the end of the session, you should be able to use the solution yourself, deploy it yourself, look at the different ways you can integrate the solution. But we'll go a little bit further as well and give you a view to the hacking tools we are using to create the awareness, right? Mobile security is a market that's been around for a while, but a lot of people of yourself, of your customers, if you ask are you using mobile security right now on your device? I think most of you will say no, right? So there's still some work to be done to show the importance of what we are doing here. And that's something I will explain. I'm not sure how many people of you participated in the session which Mary did, I think 1 or 2 weeks ago, which was more sales focused. So I'm not going to spend too much time on the presentation, but we'll share the presentation with you anyway. We'll cover a couple of items in the presentation, and then we'll just switch to the live demo on the solution, if that's okay. If there are any questions, feel free to interrupt me, right? Let me start by sharing my screen. So if all is well, you should be able to see my presentation. Mehdi, can you confirm?
Yes, I can confirm that we see everything.
Excellent, excellent. Thank you very much, thank you very much. So let's quickly walk through a couple of slides that can give you a vision on where we stand, where we are at, why we are doing this together with SentinelOne on launching a mobile offering as well, and what are some technical considerations when it comes to deployment, right? So these are a couple of the topics which we will cover, right? We'll share the presentation with you, so I'm not going to spend too much time. But very quickly, what it is, mobile threat defense, that's the only thing that you should remember, right? What the offering is about is a mobile threat defense offering. Come back in a minute what it is. We are doing this in a phased approach from a technical perspective with SentinelOne. So the end goal would be that everything which we show today in a separate console will be combined into SentinelOne's console offering, right? So anything to do with policy setting, anything to do with deployment, anything to do with threat hunting will all be in the future state consumed in SentinelOne's offer, right? At the start now, to address the market that's in front of us, we started with two consoles, the SentinelOne you're used to, and then the one we'll show you today. And we start, of course, with a mobile app, which will not change, which will be exactly the same, right? A mobile app that gets deployed on the mobile device to be able to offer. So there will be three phases. Today is phase one, right? We have a dedicated console specifically for the mobile part, which we'll cover today. The second phase will be, we'll send all of the threat data that we detect through Singularity Mobile into the SentinelOne environment. The third timeline will be everything consolidated, meaning we just keep the app on the mobile device and all the deployment happens from the SentinelOne environment, which you already know, and all the threat data will be consumed in there as well, right? Why are we launching now? Because if you look at the market, competition is launching as well, right? So some of the major competitors of SentinelOne in this space, like CrowdStrike, are developing something themselves, right? Which is a very hard thing to do. The reason is very simple. The mobile operating system is not the same as a Windows operating system, right? I always compare it for simplicity to ships. I consider that Windows is like a roll-on, roll-off ship. The old ships, the ferries, think of the ferries that that leave to Capri or that leave to Corsica or what have you, right? The ones that's where the trucks drive into the belly of it, that's a Windows system when it comes to security, meaning security can become the captain of such a ship, right? You can get access to the kernel, and that's typically what these kind of solutions do on Windows, right? The problem, if you compare it to a mobile operating system, is that everything is containerized. So let's take that analogy of the ship again. A mobile device is a container ship, right? Now, the biggest difference between both of them is that you actually do not become captain of the container ship. You are just a container sitting on the ship, just as all the other containers, and that's what you need to work on. So the tactics and the metrics you use on a Windows environment to detect and react to certain threats are not the same as on a mobile device. What we need to do within our solution is look at these metrics that are available to us, and let's make the analogy to a ship again. If you are on a ship, you can still, from that container perspective, see what direction that ship is traveling, at what speed it's traveling, if it's making a sudden turn or not, or what have you. And those are the kind of behaviors we're looking at to say, okay, this is the kind of attack that's taking place on this device, whether it's Pegasus or something else, right? This explains why it's taken a time for this market to develop, because it's not exactly the same tactics and metrics we are using. But as we go along, we've seen CrowdStrike starting to develop something. Microsoft is developing something as well with a Defender, where they're using at the moment an SDK of Bitdefender in there. So they're looking at known bets, mobile threats, which is not exactly the same coverage as Singularity Mobile. Again, bottom line here is what we have to offer with the integrated fashion with SentinelOne is way beyond the technical capabilities that any of the other competitors can offer nowadays, right? What Imperium is doing in all of this is extending SentinelOne, right? We become the extension of SentinelOne when it comes to mobile. So anything to do with mobile security, we will be more than happy to help SentinelOne there as we are one team going forward, right? Think of first meetings, handling objections you might need. Think of arranging consoles, right? We have two ways of spinning up a console. One can be for you as a partner, which would be considered a NFR, not for a resale. Another one would be, and that one you can use freely to learn, to discover, to protect your environments. The second one would be for POCs, for proof of concepts in front of your customers, right? We will assist you with hacking demos, walkthroughs. We will assist you in RFPs where needed. We've got a very big library of those, and we can assist you in the POCs, whether it's a kickoff, a follow-up, or what have you, right? The whole idea is what I believe in from a technical point of view is learning should be done in the field on an actual opportunity in an actual environment, because that's where we excel, right? And we can bring that expertise to you guys. This is the team in front of us. I'll still keep Flavien here in France on the slide for a couple of times, but Flavien used to be our sales engineer covering France. He joined SentinelOne recently, so we have a very strong integration with them, of course, and knowledge on that level. But for Italy region, it's Marcus who will be responsible for supporting you technically. The overall team is being led by Sergey, who you can see here at the top of the screen, right? But we've got coverage across Europe. Where we've seen success at the moment, who are the people buying mobile security at the moment? It are people that have understood the risk which lies in mobile, right? And they have understood the risk which lies in mobile because they are moving their own go-to-market to mobile. Think of banks, for example, right? A lot of banks have seen a shift from web banking to mobile banking, right? With the shift from web banking to mobile banking, they've also seen the increase in mobile fraud, right? So typical banks in our region will invest already heavily in mobile. Automotive, same thing. Name any kind of major European brand in Europe from a car manufacturer, and they will already be a customer of the Imperium underlying technology one way or another. Why is that? Because there again, they're seeing movements. I mean, some BMW cars you can already unlock or preheat through mobile app. So they've understood what's happening there. Government, same things. We've seen a high increase in, you know, government demands during COVID as well, with regards to, you know, going beyond the military aspect of it. So we've seen have a lot of customers within military agencies and military ministries working with us. Law firms have been using us. Healthcare has spiked during COVID again because they need to make sure that any kind of documents on their device or any kind of communication on the device was secure because of industrial spying, etc., during the development of the COVID vaccines, etc. So a lot of people that are seeing that mobile becomes a structural play in their go-to-market will be open to have a discussion when it comes to mobile. A lot of others are not there yet, right? You need to create the awareness. People only invest in security when they are aware that there is an actual need of that one. And it is always a little bit of chicken or egg story, right? So when we talk to customers, most of the times when there is a high need for security, I want very high visibility on threat data, threat telemetry on a mobile device, we typically win. If there is a high need on integration data, like I want to consume this in another environment from a threat data point of view, or I want to integrate this with multiple MDMs, which I have, one for the work floor, one for my VIPs, etc. We typically win as well, as we offer most of the solutions there, right? Not going to everything, is this new? The short answer is no, right? Mobile security really started about 15 years ago when Steve Jobs announced the first iPhone. But since then, it's been developing, right? The typical response we got from customers in the past was saying, okay, why should I need protection on my mobile device? I only do email and contacts on a mobile device, and that's all, right? There's nothing on there that's being used. Then I showed this little person, right? I would say, really, is that all that you're using? If we look at the business shifts that have been happening, also due to COVID, is that now on that mobile device, we're doing our online meetings, right? Our face-to-face meetings have been replaced by the kind of meetings we're doing right here, right? A big thing we got back from our customers was, we are now using multi-factor authentication on a mobile device, right? For people that have been in this industry for a while, remember these old RSA tokens, right? These credit card-like or key fob like tokens which we had for our one-time password, which was running on a dedicated platform that was only doing that. We are now moving that factor, that second factor, to a mobile device. Again, the same basic applies. If you can't trust the mobile device, if you can't vet its level of trust, you can't trust the second factor anymore. So this is actually something that customers brought back to us, right? And we even have a banking customer that forced RSA to use our security tools for app security to secure their multi-factor authentication solution, which is kind of nice. And then there's a lot of company tools for communication, like Slack or others that are considered IT tools at that level. But again, as in the previous time with Windows, there's a lot of shadow IT. And if we're honest, we are communicating today to our colleagues through WhatsApp, through Messenger, to other means. And then next to that, this is only corporate-owned kind of devices. Next to that, there's a very big world of private usage as well. So we've seen people using bring your own devices more and more in the arena. And they actually have valuable data to protect as well, right? Their banking applications, PayPal or what have you, their new banking applications like Google Pay or Apple Pay or what have you, maybe some cryptocurrency on there, right? That's of value. Maybe your COVID safe tickets or what have you, or health data, which is in there. So again, we can easily argue the world has changed. We're using mobile in a more strategic way, right? Yes, it's been in the news. So a couple of you might have seen in March of last year, these kind of messages that were telling you from FedEx or DHL or the postal services that a package was waiting for you, and it was doing either phishing or some app vulnerability, like on Android, typically FluBot was using an APK to install an APK on your device. If it noticed that you were running an iOS phone or an iOS device, basically, it would just try to phish your credentials, if any, right? So a lot of people have seen this, but again, nothing really happened from that. And then at the same time, a couple of months later, Pegasus was in the news, where Europe, even European governments like Hungary, were presumed to be using a spyware solution against their own, journalists, European politicians, etc. Right? So it had a high coverage on there. It was exploiting a device vulnerability, right? So this was focused on an iOS vulnerability. And so typically a device attack was being used on those, right? Now, all of them, from a technical perspective, we are able to map to MyPay, right? So you can see for the Android version or for the iOS version, what kind of steps in the attack framework it abused to get full persistence and full control of the mobile device. But these are a couple of technical mappings we are able to do. I'm not going to bore you to death with the Gartner site, just from a competitive point of view, remember that what Singularity Mobile is giving you is mobile threat defense, and what mobile threat defense should be, and I clearly say should be, is a combination of what EPP and EDR are doing on a traditional endpoint, meaning it should cover known bads, but also zero-day kind of attacks based on behavioral analysis and detection. That's what a complete coverage should be, right? Why is SentinelOne adding this? I think very simple. They've got coverage on everything except three platforms which were missing, which is iOS, Android, and Chromebooks. That those are the ones that we are adding to this equation. And so from a, let's say, value point of view, what it is we are doing is we're looking at four attack vectors: device attack vector, think of Pegasus; network attack vector, think of man-in-the-middle attacks, rogue access points; phishing, easy. It's called smishing on mobile, but any kind of link that's coming into your personal email, SMS, WhatsApp, messaging services, and then anything to do with malicious apps, or, you know, apps that are normal or that are not really malicious, but that can cause certain security or privacy issues when used internally. Think of apps that have access to your camera, can record certain items. Would you allow them or not in your meeting room, right? The biggest difference of Singularity Mobile is all of what we are doing in real time using machine learning, but we are doing it on device, meaning that we have a very, very high respect for anything that has to do with privacy. By doing stuff on device, basically, we can make sure that we don't have to send each and every inspection to the cloud, making data privacy a difficult thing to do. And on that level, we offer a kind of unique capability. We'll come back on a couple of these as we go along. We'll show you in the console what on-device actions are compared to MDM actions or integrations with an MDM or a MEM solution. We'll show you how deep we can go at finding out which kind of mobile apps are being used and what their security issues are. And we'll look at the threat data inside the console. Just as a wrap up, remember there are three kind of deployments which you can think of, right? One which is a purely standalone, meaning it's just Singularity Mobile and there's nothing integrated into it, right? In that case, it's a very manual process. I'll show you how it's done because it's easy to be consumed when you're testing out the solution yourself, right? It's not the most ideal solution because you put a lot of responsibility with the end user, without having any kind of stick to force him to install it, right? You don't have any control plane. But it is good for bring your own device. It can be followed up by looking at who installed it versus who not, right? Then a second one, which is typically used for bring your own device as well, which has some level of control, is using a kind of conditional access method, which is called MAM, Mobile Application Management, where you say, I don't want to control the device. I just want to control the condition in which business applications are being used. If you want to use Teams, we have to make sure that Singularity Mobile is running on that device, right? It's an integration we've seen with some Microsoft tools, for example. We're still in the process of getting SentinelOne added as one of the conditions when it comes to Microsoft. Of course, Microsoft is playing a little bit hardball because SentinelOne is competing with them on the Windows side of things, right? But we'll get it in there as we go along because we are in there as well, and we're competing officially with Defender ATP for Android and iOS as well, so that's not a worry. And then the last one is full MDM control, meaning you have full control of that device. If you see certain things happening, you can go as far as wiping that device remotely or what have you, right? Those are the three deployment options. Today, we'll cover the most static one, the most simple one, which is the standalone one. Anything else going to MEM or going to MDM would be an improvement in both the deployment experience, the user experience, and what have you, right? I'll just show you the worst case to start off with, right? Sometimes you will get from some people that already invest in an MDM solution, they will come back to you and they'll say, we already have an MDM, why should we use an MTD? Just use these kind of micro attack framework mappings to show that this is what an MDM covers, right, in yellow. This is what we cover if we are brought on together, right? So you can clearly see the gaps that we cover additionally. Yes, there is a good reason to work together because it's a smoother deployment process. it's a better response process from what an MDM can do, but nevertheless, MDM is not doing security in the way that we're doing, and we're not controlling the device in the way that an MDM is doing. So just see that as a kind of complementary asset there. And then on the competitive landscape, just to give you some understanding who's doing what, if you go out there, Microsoft is saying just known bad only, no zero-day detection using an SDK from Bitdefender. CrowdStrike developing their own solution, still very low in a maturity from a technical point of view. So if you go in a POC against them, you'll have an easy shot showing the value at in there. Then you have a couple of others like Trend Micro and Sophos, again, known bad detection, but they include some MDM capability in there, which we don't. We don't have any MDM capability. SentinelOne McAfee is using our technology under the hood already. VMware doesn't have a Carbon Black, doesn't have a mobile solution at this point. They're just covering the other ones. And then, yeah, Cisco has a DNS focus. Broadcom actually, or Symantec, bought a company called Skycure in the past. But again, yeah, Broadcom and Symantec didn't go really in the direction that was expected, I think, from most of us. And so that's kind of what the competitive landscape lies. Bottom line here is, if you go into a POC, if you go head to head, basically to show the technical value of this solution, you will be able to achieve that same result, right? Because of the full coverage, known bad and zero day, because of the on-device protection, which has a direct link to what we can do on GDPR or align on GDPR, because of the app analysis capabilities, which I like to call the shadow IT detection of mobile, right? We did it on Windows when we had FTP servers and our users were using Dropbox to share files to bypass the attachment limitations we had in email. But we're doing exactly the same. And then especially again, on the detail of security we bring, on the integration we bring, we are uniquely positioned, right? We've got a couple of tools for you. We'll show them today. One is the console and one is the Hacking Kit, right? So I will show you what the Hacking Kit looks like. It's called Zkit. It's a scripted environment basically that allows you to run a couple of scenarios in front of your customers. We'll come to that in a minute. And then you have your NFR or POC environments where we can spin up a console for you. How does that process work? Quite simply, you reach out to Luca or you reach out to one of the pre-sales on SentinelOne side. They have an internal process of some items they need to fill in a form. We get that request and we spin up the console basically, giving in an NFR you as a partner access with SentinelOne as well, pre-sales to be able to assist you where needed. If it's a POC, you will get access and also your customer will have access to that console to start configuring certain items. So that is kind of quick scope, not trying to be duplicate on what you saw last time. We kept it shorter, of course. These are a couple of people you can contact. So what the kind of distribution is between the support we give you, any kind of pre-sale support, reach out to Marcus, I would say, unless it's commercial, right? Anything to do with commercial or partner enablement, it will be Mehdi that takes care of it. You just met Mehdi at the beginning of the session. Anything to do with enterprise opportunities, like bigger enterprise that falls under responsibility of one of the account executives on SentinelOne side of things, Alfonso will be your man on there.
Yeah.
So,
yes.
Short conclusion.
We have a question before you go on the technical deep part. So we have a question here. In case of an Intune rollout of SentinelOne Mobile using Intune MDM, is there any actions that users need to take? And if you can give a little bit more information on how we integrate with, please.
Sure, I will show it. I will show it in the console how we integrate. So basically the integration gives us two important advantages, right? One is the deployment, right? Being controlled by Intune or by Endpoint Manager, as they call it now, what we are capable to do is basically go as close to a zero-click, zero-touch kind of deployment where the user does not have to accept certain things, accept certain rights and what have you, right? That's number one. So you can actually push it to the device and make sure that the integration with the user is as limited as possible. What are the factors that depend here? It's the capabilities you allow or you configure, like will you use a local VPN or not? Certain items will require a user response, but again, with Intune, we can go as close as possible to zero touch, zero click, meaning no user interaction, right? That's one. The second thing is that from a device action point of view, we detect something. Our scope is quite limited on how we can react. It's only what the operating system gives us, right? I'll show you in a minute in the console what that means, but we can't do a remote wipe, for example. Even if we look at the app analysis and if we look at the shadow IT, which I call it on mobile apps, we can't see apps on iOS if there is no MDM profile present, right? We need an MDM profile to get the apps of an iOS device into the Singularity Mobile solution. Hope that answers the questions, Nedi.
Yes, and there is an integration possible with Kaspersky MDM. I don't think so, correct? What we do in this case?
Not at the moment, no. So again, Kaspersky MDM, like the example I gave for Sophos and Trend Micro, is that you've fallen into between two brackets. Yes, you have some MDM capability, which typically is worse than what Intune can give you or Mobile Iron can give you or Workspace ONE can give you, right, from a capability point of view. So it's not that it is an MDM profile as such, right? So not the capabilities you want. Typically, the buy-off on security is exactly the same. Kaspersky, alike Sophos, alike Trend Micro, et cetera, will focus on known bad and will not focus on zero-day kind of capabilities from detection point of view. Make sense?
Good. Thank you. It makes definitely sense. And by the way, we can always install in standalone for any case when MDM. Can you talk about it just before to start on the console, please?
Sure. So from a standalone point of view, basically, and that's what we're going to walk through, right? I'm going to walk you through. We're really going in live, showing you how we deploy, right? So on one hand, I'll walk you through the console, how you create the user and stuff like that, right? On the other hand, you can see my very big hand here, which is not really big in real life, but it's the camera doing so. It is big. Anyway, jokes aside, I'll show you on the device itself, right? This is my personal device, as you can see, running two separate instances. I have CentOS 1 right here, right? I'm not sure if you guys are seeing that. You should, right? Can you see it, Midi?
Yes, absolutely. Yes, cool. Absolutely.
So let me start here already. Let me deinstall it, right? That makes it a little bit more attractive. Let me deinstall CentOS 1, right? So it's gone. It's not under MDM profile, right? Just a normal Samsung device, basically. Two sides on it. You can see that on this side, I have the standard is Imperium one installed. On this one, I don't have anything anymore, right? So we'll start from zero and reintegrate this from a user point of view, standalone. Okay, make sense? Let me start. So when we start, get that one as well. So when we start, basically what I'm going to show you today is really worst case scenario, meaning I'm doing everything manually, right? No integration. I'll show you what the integrations look like, but we'll do no integration just for now, right? So basically what I will do is I'll get my I'll just delete my user here. Let me quickly find it. It's this one. All right. Let me be a little bit easy here and delete it. Okay, so user is deleted, right? So how do I start about this? Let's say I wanna make a new user, right? First thing is I'll go under actions again. We're doing everything manually here, right? Everything else I'll be telling you and showing you as an improvement of what I'm showing you, right? But standalone, create a user. I'll create a user, and what's the first thing is that you'll see there is a full role-based access control mechanism in there, right? So we can assign certain roles to them. This will become important when you want to start using this already in a kind of MSP offering from a technical point of view, right? Because what you now have, you have one environment and you can start defining roles and groups and what have you to really make it easy to create them, right? Basically, what I'm going to do here, just for the purpose of the demo, is I'm going to create an end user, right? I need to put in an email address, which I nicely copied. So you can see here, heathnobles@central1, right? I'll just put in my first name, I'll put in my last name. And what I then have, which is an important one when creating something here, is that I have the capability of assigning device groups to it, right? What are device groups? Device groups offer you a couple of possibilities, right? It offers you the possibility on one hand side to create policies specifically for this group, right? It will also help you with the role-based administration in there, right? So what I'm now just going to do is that I'm creating a user. I've got my end user nomination here. I've got my email, first name, last name, and I assign it to a device group. I create a user, right? As you can see here on the left-hand side, it will send a welcome email to the given user, creates, and my user is launched on that one, right? So basically, what you'll now see is that I've got an end user here that's been created. If all goes well, on my personal mail, I should get a message as well, right? Which you can see here, which says you are ready. And these are the couple of steps that you need to do, right? I'm gonna walk you through it each and every step. So two steps basically to do. One is you need to install the app, right? On Android and iOS. Second thing is you need to activate it, right? Activation can happen in two ways. Activation can happen either by clicking the link, of course, on your device, not on the computer, right? Or by scanning the QR code, of course, on the computer, not on the device, right? So that's the kind of activation steps which you can do. Before I go into the view on the endpoint itself and install CentralOne and what have you, I quickly wanted to touch upon the device groups on this level, right? So we now create one user, right? Second improvement, what you can do is you can upload multiple users again. Again, no integration whatsoever. If you upload multiple users, what you typically do is upload a CSV file, right? What CSV file? Well, you can download an example here, but basically it looks like this. What you need, email, first name, last name, right? As we just did. Password, only dependent if you want to assign it to a, admin kind of, right, that can access the console. Otherwise, just the device group as I did, and you upload this, and in bulk, all of the emails will be sent out. Make sense? So this is kind of uploading multiple users, right? I just did one for now. I want to show you two items which are important here, right? One item is where can we create these device groups you're talking about? Well, you go under devices, and once you click devices here, on the right-hand side, you have local device groups, right? It's as simple as going here, adding a group and saying, okay, I want demo, let's call it EXN Italy, for example, right? This is the demo for Exclusive Networks Italy we're doing today, right? And just creating that group, right? This means that the group that I create right now will be able to use for policies in the future, but also for this, what I call role-based administration, right? So we've got the users, right? We visited the users. We explained on this side of things how we create one user versus how we create multiple users at once, right? We explained what the roles are that you can give, right? We explained that you can create local device groups as the one we just did for Exclusive Networks Italy right here, right? Now, where do you create that role-based access? I'll come back to the policy in a second step. Where do you create this role-based access is, we've done users, we've done devices with the local device groups. We now go to manage, and under manage, what you have there is that you have roles, which you can see here, right? Under roles, what you can do is basically say, okay, each and every individual role that you have here will just say, okay, if we look at it, this role gets access to which of the items which you can find here, dashboard insights, right? Thread log, apps, devices, users, and policy, right? This is where you can assign the rights to, and then you can say, okay, is it a read-only view, or is it a read-write, meaning view and edit capability? You yourself can toggle this as far as you'd like and say, okay, these guys are only into evaluating what kind of applications we are using. That's the only thing I want them to see, right? So for example, app reviewer, if we want to call it that way, make it a little bit prettier. App reviewer only reviews apps, for example. And what I can now do is say, okay, and he can, by the way, only do that for the group we just created, which was, if I'm not mistaken, how did I call it? Somebody help me out. Demo EXM, yeah, there it is. And so I can create this role as only being the app reviewer for this given group, right? So only for the apps that are coming from this kind of group, right? So you can define the roles as you'd like. So what you'll see in this demo, for example, is you can create mobility admins that can only look at policies and stuff like that. You can look at security admins that mostly look at threats, events, and thread log data, etc. But you have a way of doing full role-based access. Does that make sense? Any questions, maybe?
Not so far. But we are open for questions now. I think, yeah, that all is very clear.
Cool. So what I'll now do is I'll flip to the other side of things. And if all is well, you can now see my phone on the right-hand side as well. Is that correct?
Yes, it is correct.
Perfect. So let me go to my Gmail and let me go to my Sentinel-1 message, right? So I open it on the computer. You can have it here again, right? So again, I've got these couple of simple steps which I can use here. It's a little bit better, right? So this is the Android device. So I'll just select Android, brings me to the store. I'm installing it as we speak, right? So dependent on your network connection, not such a big package, right? And then I can just open it, right? Now to open it, what he will say is that, okay, how are you going to, identify yourself as being a license holder for this solution? Two ways, QR code. If I want to do the QR code, I'll have to go back here and show this one on the screen, right? And then I can scan the QR code, which is in there, or I can do it via email. So if I go back to my emails, right? I have my email on my device. I can, of course, not scan the QR code right here, right? But I can push here, activate Sample One, right? By doing so, it will flip back to the solution and start installing it, right? Now, in this case, everything is configured, so it will ask me for a couple of authorizations. Let me take that away, to be allowed, right? For example, the first one will be localization, right, which you can approve or not. Then it's the operating system that is defining that, and then access to your storage on the device, basically, where again it just guides you to allowing that, which is not just the case for Sample One, which is the case for other items on your phone as they are there. And then in this case, since it's Samsung, we do have a specific integration into Samsung Knox as well. You can start using the Samsung Knox one, which I will not do on this case because I'm installing it on my private device, right, on private profile of my device. And then it just gives you a tutorial on a friendly way to go about phishing, right? You can ignore that or not show that, or we can show it as a way how phishing can be done on a friendly way, especially on BYOD kind of environments, right? So I'll show you. One way to do so would be to do what we call a long press. So you can see a link here. Sorry, my phone is in French, but if you do a long press on your link, you can share the link, right? And so by sharing the link, instead of sharing the link through a normal application, I'm going to send it through Sample One, and it's going to tell me, okay, I scanned that link and it seems to be without a danger. This is purely, let's say, manual. You put it in the hands of the users, but you give them a tool basically where they can try it out, right? And then I just terminate it, right? Another way would be to, for example, go to the phishing side of things, which is on top here, where we end up again on that, you know, link sharing and show me, or where you can say, okay, just copy in a link of any given site, right, and check it out and see whether or not this given site is a problem. This is Google Italy, so clearly it's not a problem, right? But these are the kind of two mechanisms you can put in the hands of your user, right? So now we're fully up and running. The solution is installed, and it immediately gives me some IDs basically on what it's telling me. Some of the items are configurable in the portal, right? So Zone de Danger, which is a danger zone, which shows you Wi-Fi hotspots in surroundings that might be dangerous, is something that you can configure yes or no, right? If you want to show that. Let me show you in parallel where that sits, right? So zip, let me go a little bit. So it's enabled in this case, right? Danger zone, so that's why it's showing as well. You can decide not to enable it, right? The same with app risk lookup, you can enable it that a user can look at the risk of a given application or try to find it if it's an issue, right? So that it's something I don't think I've got it configured on this one, but where you have the capability of showing the as you can see, it's a little bit slow on this. No, I'm not showing my screen, so it's a little bit slow on this side because of the fact that I just started rolling out the Sample One here, so it's still analyzing my application as we go along, right? What it is saying to me is it's looking at the security of the device itself. It's looking at, is it Android device? Is it rooted? Is it compromised? Is it vulnerable to certain items, right? Is USB debugging on? Is developer mode on? Is it, you know, encrypted or not? Do you have a screen lock? Do you have those kind of things in there, right? So in this case, everything looks great. If I look at my network, it will look at my private network here, which is generally, and say, okay, is this a trusted network or is this trying to do something fishy over here, right? And then it looks at applications basically. And in this case, it will be slow at first because you can see it's still gathering all of the data, but it will start to flag to me that certain of the apps I'm using might be sideloaded because they're still in beta or what have you. So it will bring back this kind of information. And this is what the user can work with. This is what the user can see, right? It's up to the policy configuration. Let me sharpen this again, to see, okay, this is what's problematic, right? In this case, it will say, okay, I already found one application, Astus in this case, that was sideloaded on this device. It's an application by Samsung. So it will flag certain items already to the user, but otherwise this is what will happen on the user experience side of things, right? And so fully installed, fully working, it's now scanning all of the application on the device. Why is that? It's an Android device. I don't need an MDM profile, so all of my data will be sent back to the console.
Yes, Gert, that is a very important point. I think that we should a little bit clarify a little bit more potentially on this application analysis is done only once, correct? When we do install the Sentinel One, it's only once and after it's done. And by the way, we underline that it's an Android device. You don't need an MDM to have the analysis. But if it is for iOS, you will need to have the MDM. Could you clarify this point for the audience, please?
Yes. Yeah, so what happens is basically on Android, we are an MTD solution, right? Mobile Threat Defense solution. Android will say an MTD solution on Android can collect information from the device, these parameters. Remember when I was talking about the container ships? On an Android container ship, let's say, we can see the other containers that are next to us, right? On a iOS container ship, let's say, we need to have an MDM profile on board, meaning there needs to be an MDM to be able to ship the applications back to us. If there is no MDM profile, the only way we would able to see the applications, if the customer has a list of applications he's using on iOS and he uploads them manually to the portal, that would be the only thing. It's not a limitation on our side, it's a limitation on iOS, meaning that if there is no MDM profile, the app information is not being shared with the MTD. Make sense?
Perfectly clear. Thank you, Gert. Any question to clarify any points, please, audience? If not, we can continue, Gert. I will stop you if there are more questions. Thank you.
Perfect. Not a problem. So what we can now do, okay, we installed it manually, right? What you would be able to do now is to say, okay, we've got some dashboards and some insights here, right? If I go to the insights, and again, we are working on the worst case scenario, meaning it's a fully standalone implementation, right? What I would be able to do now is to say, okay, I've sent this out to 273 people in total, right? 220 of them are activated. We've got the information that this solution has been activated, right? But I can see that 90% or 53 haven't, right? So what I would be able to do is say, okay, show me the list of these 50-something users, 53 devices that have not done, and I could follow up with these people to say, okay, guys, you need to install this application, right? If not, this is just because we're in a standalone mode, right? But we give you a kind of visibility on saying, okay, the installed ones, the activated ones versus the ones that are still pending in there, right? So this could be a good follow-up from your point of view in this kind of a scenario to do so. Anything we do from here will be an improvement on the customer experience, user experience, by integrating into an MDM or a kind of NAM solution, right? I'll quickly show you how that's done, right? So up till now, we've done everything manually. Yes, there are some use cases to create device groups, especially when it comes to role-based access and what have you. But from a user point of view, it's so much stronger to use, you know, whatever integration you might already have with an Active Directory environment or a SAML environment, Azure AD or what have you, that's already integrated into your Intune or Endpoint Manager, as was mentioned in the beginning, right? Where do you find it? You go back to manage, right? And under manage, we have two important integrations, right? Integration number one is an integration into an MDM. I'll quickly show you how that goes. But what's important here to notice is that we can support multiple MDMs within one console, one solution. So you can see in this one, for example, I have a Citrix MDM, I have a Microsoft Endpoint Manager, I have another Endpoint Manager, I have a Mobile Iron Core in there, a Mobile Iron Cloud in there, I have another Endpoint Manager, I'll probably have something from AirWatch, Workspace ONE as well in there. So you can see multiple MDMs can be integrated into one platform, right? How does it work? Well, integration means you as a partner are not bothered by having Endpoint Manager or Intune talk to Singularity Mobile, right? It's being taken care of for you already. And each and every version change will make sure that same integration remains working, right? How do you do it? Let's take the example of Microsoft. You just select the MDM with whom you can install. The question earlier, do we support Kaspersky MDM? Answer is no, it's not in here, right? The ones that we support are in here, and we support them at the same time. You just click the integration you want to do, in this case, the Microsoft one. And then basically just the four steps to complete is to say, okay, step one was the easy one. Who's the MDM provider you're using? Step two is, okay, how can I connect to Azure AD? where do I speak to the Intune environment, and which kind of groups within the MDM do you want to integrate into your environment here, right? Step one, let me show you another view, for example, for SOTI. So on SOTI, you see kind of the other side of things, so we choose SOTI. What kind of information do we need to make this integration happen? It's making sure we can point to the right spot where SOTI is finding itself. What's the username password to connect to SOTI? What kind of synchronizations do we want to do? Have the API key ready for that. And then just again, select what kind of groups we want to integrate in. And we're done naming. We can now use Endpoint Manager or SOTI to help deploy Singularity Model on the device. This will give you the advantage of getting closer to zero touch, getting closer to zero click, really granularly defining what you want, but it will help you in the policies as well, as we will see later on, right? That's integration number one. I'll quickly cover, as we are here, integration number two as well, which is not about deployment, which is not about zero touch, zero click, or how do I react to anything you detect. It's about, I detected something, I have a log, I have a threat event, where do I send this threat event to be consumed, right? And so again, if you click here on data export, we can integrate with multiple, let's say, data stores that are out there. We integrate with the Microsoft ones, if that's the one that you might be using as a SOC or as an managed detection and response kind of framework. Of course, this is where step one of SentinelOne comes in as well, right? Which makes logical sense to be added there. But we can typically do it with anything that's scene related, syslog related, or we can even do it with anything that's dashboard related or that's using a REST API to communicate with, right? So any kind of the data that we have in here, this should not be a silo just purely for mobile. We would be able to send off our environment and have you consume it from a managed service provider point of view in a different environment, if that makes sense. Okay, two integrations. Again, I think I emphasized in the beginning that integration and security are the key components of what we have to offer. And these are clearly, the forest pushed integrations that are available in the market today. Any questions from your side, Mehdi?
Not yet.
You can see. Cool.
Okay. So he's clear. Boy,
perfect. That's perfect. So we did the deployment, right? We explained the users, the groups, the role-based access administration and what have you. We showed you, okay, if you do it standalone, what's the experience, right? Okay, the user had to accept a couple of items around location, about storage, those kind of things, etc. We then explained that with an MDM, you can make that process smoother, right? We showed you kind of the installation process manually on the user device. Let's now go to the policy side of things, right? On the policy side of things, again, you can create policies with integrations or you can create policies without any integrations, right? Again, what you will see if we cover the policies is that all aligns back in most of the cases to the groups that you have selected, to the groups you have created and those kind of items, right? So if I give you the example over here, I could go back and I'll probably type it to go quicker and find this demo exclusive networks IT group, which I created. And I can now start building a policy specifically for these kind of environment, right? How should you interpret a policy? This is what we do at the core. It's a threat policy. There's about 70 detections we are doing. And the detections we are doing are either related to the app, for example, right? Somebody's tampering with an app. It can be related to the network, to the device, for example, right? Device is compromised via a certain attack. It can be network related, man in the middle. It can be device related, Pegasus, clearly a device issue. It can be phishing related. Risky site, link tapped or link visited, right? Or blocked or what have you. So it's again, one of these four categories that we cover, right? What choices do you have as a partner? you can decide whether or not to trigger this alert, right? We categorize them by low, elevated, critical, what have you. So you can decide, do I want to see this alert, this detection happening, or do I not want to see this happening? What are some corner cases where you might say, you know, it's nice to know, but I don't want to use it. For example, typically captive portal item things, right? If you go to a hotel, there's a captive portal inside, etc., which you need to connect to and stuff like that. It's nice to know it doesn't add anything from a security value, maybe in a certain perspective, right? So you can decide to not activate this given detection on that one. We give it a severity. You can overrule it and give it your own severity. We give you an information of what it is. And now comes in the configuration part of things, right? First configuration is, should we alert the user or not, right? What kind of options do you have? Well, you have the option. So all of these fields basically have a standard text, which is in there, which gets automatically translated to the language the customer is using. So if I look well, it will be in Italian for most of your users, right? So these are all the libraries we kind of integrated into our solution. We've been extremely thorough, in my opinion, because if I look at my native language, which is Dutch, you can see that we have the Dutch, which they speak in Holland, the Flemish, which they speak where I live in Belgium, but also the Middle Age Dutch, which is weird to be in there, but I mean, I think it's kind of fun in there. The nicest thing about the detection basically is you decide if the user gets alerted, but we give you an additional field basically where you can say, let's create a button for them, which we call, for example, contact IT, right? Where here you put the web portal interface of your service desk or support desk, right? Meaning that if we give this alert now, it will have an actionable button in there. When he pushes that button, he ends up on your ticketing system. Right. So I think that's a kind of nice feature and flexibility we give is, should you alert the user or not, right? Let's try to keep the noise to the user as low as possible, as with any security solution. And then we've detected something. Now we have two ways to go about it, right? Either we tell the device to take an action because we are in standalone, as I just deployed on my personal device, right? And then we are limited to the device actions that the operating system gives us, right? So by clicking this little wheel here, you will see what kind of device actions we have, right? We only have four on Android: disconnect Wi-Fi, network sinkhole, disable Bluetooth, and total unsecured traffic, right? On iOS, even worse, we only have three, right? Again, not a limitation on what we do, a limitation on what the operating system gives us to play around, right? The biggest exception on all of this is the integration we do with Samsung, because there any one of these would apply because it's the Android actions, but we can go as far as disable an app, uninstall an app, block an app, isolate it from the network. We can even go so far as doing what we call DLP. I didn't add the key in this environment. We need a Samsung Knox key, which is free of charge, right, which you can use. And I'll quickly show you where that ends up. It ends up right here under the Samsung Knox KPI license, right? This is where you add this given key in there. But basically, by having that key integrated into your environment, you are able to go for this Samsung Knox DLP, data loss prevention policy, which allows you, which I can show you here, which allows you to say, okay, we'll enable the Knox MTD capability. What it now does basically in this case is saying, okay, we are doing DLP, but we're not looking at data. We don't care about data. We don't look at data. There's no privacy issues with it. We don't look at data classifications. We only look at a threat event happening, a detection we do, and the potential interfaces through which any information, any data can leak out at that moment, meaning we can disable Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, cellular, NFC, beam, what have you, but we can block Bluetooth sharing. We can block a copy to be made, right? We can block the clipboard. SD card transfer, screen captures, we can even go as far as wiping device data, which is nice because it's GDPR extremely friendly, but we don't look at the data itself, right? So that's kind of what we're doing here. Are there any questions on your side, Mehdi?
No, I think it's very clear. I think that I put in the chat that the license is included in Sentinel One Security. They don't need to buy an extra license.
They have to ask it to Samsung, but the Samsung Knox license for this is free of charge. So if you're a Samsung user, you have free access to the license. You just have to add it to the console. No additional charges indeed.
Cool. Perfect.
So we looked at the threats, we looked at what we can do on the device. Now, typically, once we integrate with Microsoft, for example, what we will do is we will not take the reaction action. Let me find a Intune or Microsoft. This is Workspace ONE. There should be at least one in there. There we go. Mobile Iron still. And then we have Intune. Right. So basically what we're now doing, this is for this given group that has an integration into Intune. Basically what we're now doing is saying, okay, we detect something, we give a user alert, yes or no, but we're not going to take a device action. We are just going to inform the EMM, right? We're going to say no action to be taken, or we inform the EMM. No action means we just give the alert to the user, or we make the detection, but nothing happens more. Or we inform the EMM, meaning now you end up in the Microsoft environment again from Intune Endpoint Manager, and you start defining what should happen if I see this, right? Should I do a remote wipe? Should I do something else? What would be my response to it, right? Again, where we are limited to disconnecting Wi-Fi on Android, but we can't do it on iOS. Intune would be able to say, okay, I want to do this on iOS, I want to disconnect Wi-Fi, because I can see that you are connected to, let's say, a rogue access point, right here, or I can see man in the middle is happening on this network, basically, I want to disconnect Wi-Fi. We inform the EMM, in this case, Intune Endpoint Manager, that this action happened. They take the action, basically, to say, okay, let's shut down the Wi-Fi. In this case, right? This is where the integration comes from. So MDM integration, two abilities you have. One is make the implementation, the deployment more seamless. The second one is a more granular way to react to any kind of the detections we are making, okay? So let's conclude the policy setting with the following two items. One of it is phishing, right? Phishing, we have a couple of flavors in there, and it's up to the configuration how you want to go about it. What would be my advice to you when you're testing phishing is start with phishing and then evaluate if you want to go deeper into web content filtering, right? We do have web content filtering in there. You can see it's a difference between toggling these boxes, again, assigning it to the right group, right, which you want to use. So you want to only do it on the exclusive networks IT environment again. You select that one first, and then you decide what you want to do. Basically, what you'll see is that I already had this URL sharing capability in there. On phishing, we have a couple of possibilities here. One is to start using a local VPN, meaning that any kind of link that gets clicked on the device get sent in this local loop, basically into SentinelOne to be scanned, right? Where you can say, okay, do I allow the user to control it or not? Should I block the URLs I see in there? And then on the other side, should I send the data off to remote server for additional inspection, meaning it doesn't just stay into the device itself, or should I respect privacy and just say, okay, you can use the app on the device, but you can't talk to a remote server outside, right? So phishing protection, if you start with it, start building it up. First, start with this one, right? If you want to go a little bit further, you can go to enhanced phishing protection and web content filtering. Nevertheless, it will look at any kind of URL that's being called upon within the web content filtering category, which is below, right? And so what you will see is that on a certain category, for example, security and risk, you will see that there are some predefined actions in there, meaning that if we see within a given app or a given communication a certain URL linking to cryptocurrency or mining or what have you, it will block and create a threat, right? You can define yourself what kind of threats you want to, or what kind of reaction you want to do. But again, make sure that you go to this about in a granular way, right? There can be some arguments whether or not we need web content filtering on a mobile device, or if that should be the role of a secure web gateway, right? Like Zscaler is offering or other people are offering in the cloud. It's a kind of architectural discussion. What was my view on this is that in case you're using a secure web gateway, I would, you know, try to bring everything together there. The only use case where you could say, okay, we are kind of blind is, you know, if it's on 4G or what have you, but then again, you know, solutions with secure web gateways would allow you to tunnel traffic as well on that level, right? So the whole question is, where do you want to do this? Is it on device? Yes, we have the capability. Is it in the secure web gateway? Then limit yourself just to the phishing protection on that level, right? So that about phishing. So we looked at threat policies, we looked at phishing, we looked at the specific Samsung Knox integration. The last thing, and I think one of the very cool things we have in here, this requires the full license at SentinelOne. I think that SentinelOne offers the full license here, which is about looking at what I would call this shadow IT for applications, right? For mobile apps. Same thing as in the Windows side of things, people are using so many apps, so many different apps, it becomes very hard to see whether or not this puts a certain issue with your security posture. As you can see that in this case, we have already 34,000 apps that have been detected on one of the devices inside this group, right? I think we showed about, if I'm not mistaken, 200 something like devices. So these already, you know, come to 34,000 apps in there. What this app review kind of allows you to do is to say, okay, you can look at characteristics, right? So let me give you a privacy example. Show me all of the apps that have access to the camera, right? So that are already installed and have access to the camera, and show those that do not only do that, but can also record audio and record video at the same time, right? I now end up with a manageable list of 50 applications that have the capability to access the camera and record audio and video at the same time, right? I can now start looking at them and reviewing them one by one to say, okay, would I allow them or not? I just made it manageable, right? Which wasn't the case looking at 34,000 applications, right? So this is a kind of a security, use case. I can use a security use case as well and say, okay, we want to see all the applications that are capable of doing a VPN, right? Because, you know, it might be outside of our control if they do, and we don't see the data streams in that one. Up with 225, and I might combine that with, for example, saying, show me those apps that can make a VPN but also have vulnerabilities in the SSL communication. Typically, looking at an app that has the capability to VPN, you would expect they have due diligence on anything in their app to be secured from an SSL point of view and have no weaknesses. Still, we see one app having the two combinations into one app. And then you can go and look a little bit deeper on what is that app, what does it look like, etc., and define whether or not you would allow this app from running inside your environment. Okay? You can just save them, it will give you a list. And so let me take this away. So, but for example, here we have a list looking at ID all apps that use full VPN and contain vulnerabilities, three of them. If you click on that, you'll get a list of these apps basically that are in there under that site, or suspicious malware. However they configured it, these would be the ones that we are looking at. This one, for example, main activity, is the one that you'll see popping up when you do the Zkit demo on the site. Okay. Any questions, maybe?
Yes, Gert, absolutely. Could you speak a little bit more about the VPN to better give details on how it should work and how it should be configured in the console, please?
Yeah, so I'll let that up to our good friend Marcos, if that's okay. But basically, we work with the logic of a local VPN on our side to intercept that, typically for the phishing side of things. Marcos, I'm not sure if you want to clarify a little bit on this topic. You might be on mute.
Yes, sorry, I was putting on the headphones. Can you hear me okay?
Now we can. Yeah. We can. Go ahead.
Okay. As you were showing, you should set it up on the VPN settings, okay? So you should set it up where you are. The thing is that you can add a specific SSID for Wi-Fi's, okay, and set up different DNS, okay? And for iOS, you can configure a specific VPN, okay?
Yeah. Okay. Perfect. I hope that answers the question, maybe.
Or could you clarify a little bit more if there is another VPN used by in a device that could interfere, and we need to make really cautious to activate the VPN checks? Just could we go on that to avoid deployment issues when we do install SentinelOne Singularity, please?
Mm. Yeah, I think we can. I'm not sure, Marcos, if you are ready to take that on now, or if we should do that on a follow-up session. What's your view?
Okay, I can do I can double check it and do a follow-up session. But you know, the local VPN can be enabled and disabled, and can be allowed to be enabled and disabled by the user as well, as you saw it, you know, in the phishing thing. Okay, excellent. It usually is started on when it's required. Okay.
Cool. Yeah, perfect. Thank you, Marcos. Let me terminate on this one. So we now saw the apps, right? We saw a given app, etc. How deep can we go on a given app, right? And let me just show you an example here. I have a banking app which I'm not using, which is not mine, but I just installed it on my device. It's not showing me here. There we are. Basically, we can go extremely deep, right? So we started with creating an app policy, show me everything that has access to the camera and the recording and those kind of items. Once you end up with the list of the apps, as I showed you previously, what you can do is go at the end here, basically, and under at the end, basically, you can get a technical report, executive reports, JSON reports, anything you like, right? I'll give you a view on the technical report. It does trigger a pop-up blocker on my side because it's a separate PDF report which opens. This is a Belgian banking app, right? We give them a privacy scoring and a security scoring. The logic of the scoring is that it's opposite as we learn in school, meaning a high score is bad, a low score is good, right? And what we do is say, okay, we'll explain how we come to this privacy risk and the security risk. For example, we say on the privacy risk, we say we give this a lower score on privacy because we actually found API keys that are exposed, meaning we can just see them in clear text, right? Which you might not expect in a bank app. We'll also say the application has access to the camera, which makes a lot of sense for a banking app because you need to be able to scan QR codes for payments, right? But from a privacy point of view, it might be a concern, right? So we're very detailed in what we are telling on that level. Same is true on security. We will say that, you know, we found Windows binaries, for example, in that. We saw the use of JavaScript inside this given applications. We even go as far, this is a report of close to 100 pages. So I'm cheating a little bit here. I should try to spell it correctly, right? But I'm cheating a little bit here by using the find functions because otherwise it'll just let me scroll to close to 100 pages. It gives you an OWASP summary as well, right? And so Let me go to the right one, right here. You can see that from Noah's point of view, 5 out of 10 have failed, right? And we'll just categorize them as we go along. And under the insecure data storage here, you can see that again, we find now more details about this API key we found. We can see what application the API key is connecting to. It's Google Android Maps, but you can actually see the API key in clear again. Is it a big issue? No, it's Google Maps, right? But it shows you how deep we can go on analyzing these apps, which is really a big plus of the solution. Okay. And then to conclude on my side, because I definitely want to give Marcus the time he prepared to show you the hacking demo, I'll go through a couple of other items a little bit quicker, or should we do the hacking demo on a separate occasion? What's the view of the Luca and maybe what's the view of the audience on that one?
I think it's okay. I think that the audience, there is no questions so far. I think we could switch to Zkit. If there is any more questions, I will let you know.
Yeah, so I'll quickly show you a couple of items that I think that are of use here, right? GDPR from a privacy setting again, we have the capability of going back to your specific group and apply, for example, GDPR settings in there, meaning for these kind of people within that group, we don't collect specific location data, we don't collect URLs they clicked on, we don't collect the apps they are using, because apps can give you an idea of who's been using the application, you know, who's the user of that application. So this is a nice one, which we can do. From a threat hunting point of view, there's a couple of ways you can go about to look at a given threat level of a user, right? So on one hand, you would be able to say, let me look at a specific user, right? So let me look at mine, for example. So this would be a way to look at it for one individual user, right? And it will say, okay, this is one warning. You can see again, information it was giving me, it tells me whether or not it was vulnerable to checkmate or what have you, but it will then give you an overview of specific threats that's been detected for this kind of environment, right? Which is again the side-loaded app which is in there, right? So you can do it on a per device kind of a way. You can also do it in different ways. So any of the context we are giving you here about you know, the threats detected or networks and those kind of items. Anything you see here in the list from an events point of view will bring you to that specific device, right? So for example, we can see 6 out of 221 devices being jailbroken. By going to those, you will get the selection of these 6 devices which are there, right? The same with insights, anything you see in here, critical devices, there's 16 in the past 90 days that are considered critical. Show me the ones and it will just bring you the list of devices that are considered critical. The same applies for anything you find in here. So anything that gives you a context of saying, these are all of the operating systems being used on different devices that have been deployed. Some of them are upgradable. Some of them are not upgradable, so they have a vulnerability, but you can't upgrade them, right? These are of interest, of course, because you can do something about it. There is a vulnerability, but there's a patch available. Show me all the Android ones, for example. Again, simply clicking on them will bring you to the correct list of what you're doing, right? So anything in here from a context point of view, from an event point of view, and those kind of things will be visible for you. And then basically what you can do is you can start looking at the specific threats yourself. So let me, for example, only take the critical ones over here. And it will give you, okay, this is some of the items which we saw for this given device. It will tell you from a MITRE point of view, if it was singular, like one event, or if it was a composite event, meaning we saw multiple steps happening from a rogue access point to something else and what have you. And then for each and every event, it will give you an overview of its composite, like these are the steps that happened in between, right? You connect to a rogue, to an unsecured Wi-Fi network. It was detected as being a rogue access point. There was a man in the middle happening on the device. And so whatever information you want to get out of this, you will find it in here, right? So let me give you another example. It will map it to the MicroTactics, basically saying an Android app could intervene at these kind of stages. It's critical. This is the information we're bringing. Do we have specific location data or not, which is not the case in this case, because it's not configured that way. And then we give the full information about that threat event. What was it? What was the file path, etc. We give the process list that was running on the device, and we can give you some more contextualized device information on that one, right? Let me show you a last one, maybe quickly. See this one, if it has specific deeper location data in there. So here you can see clearly that we have location data, right? We pinpointed the specific location really detailed. At that moment in time, we're getting much more information as well on what were the nearby networks while you were connected to that given network. What was the network status, for example? And what was the exactly pinpointed location where the user was at? Okay, very, very quickly on what you can consume. We can do a separate session, of course, if needed. But so any kind of view has an addition in this one. What I want to conclude with is that specifically for where sometimes we get a question, and we just did a mobile threat report release together with SentinelOne, by the way. On which we looked at the mobile threat landscape for last year. Typically, if you look at where do we find the most, let's say, vulnerabilities overall, it will be Android. But if you then look at what were the most 0 days, it will be iOS, right? So which one is safer? They're different, right? The attack vectors are different as well, right? Meaning that from an OS risk point of view, iOS might be riskier because there's always one version for the whole installed base, right? Where with Android, you've got Samsung, you've got different other brands that have their own variation on Android, which makes it, you know, a more kind of scattered landscape on that level. Where Android devices will be attacked a lot of times through APKs, through applications, iOS devices will typically be attacked through profiles, right? By the use of profiles, basically, that gets installed on the device. And that's where we get to the hacking demo kit we have. So I asked Marcus to prepare for you guys a hacking demo on an iOS device with a, let's say, fully deep compromise, which we do on there, which is something that typically Marcus can do and we use in kind of demo environments. We do offer you as a partner the capability as well to get your hands on a specific hacking demo environment. Let me quickly show you. There's just two requirements there. We're using a virtual environment. You have to install a ISO image, basically. So let me just launch it very quickly. We install that one, and you need a USB dongle, right? Which looks like, I'm not sure. Can you see my camera, Mini, or not?
Yes, now yes.
Okay.
Yes, yes. Right.
Let me quickly show you on this camera. It looks like this, right? So it's a very small dongle. Instead of using a pineapple or what have you, we're just using something like that, basically. And this is what will become the rogue access point in the demo, right?
Yes. Let me just explain that we can find that in Amazon for a few euros. This is a small hardware only, correct?
Yes, it is. It is. It's hardly costs anything on there. So that's the problem. Okay. So you can see my screen again, hopefully.
Yeah.
Yeah. So this is what Zkit is about. So we branded it. Customized completely for SentinelOne, right? What it gives you, basically, it gives you the possibility to run a couple of scripted attack scenarios. I'm not going to show all of them to you because of the time, and then I do want to give Marcus the stage as well. But I'll quickly show you, I'm not going to the use case myself, but quickly show you how easy it is, right? It needs internet connectivity, of course, we're using it to talk to you. It needs USB connectivity. Quite simply, you just select, my screen's here because I can't see what I'm doing. You just select the routing point, right, in this case. So if I refresh now, you can see that both of them should be active, my internet connectivity, my USB connectivity. It then starts backend services and creates out of the USB dongle, which I showed you, a rogue access point, right? When I start the services here, basically it will get up and running. You can see this little bouncing thingy next to the title here. Once that is done, normally all processes should be active, right? And this will bring you into the demo cases. There's three of them, right? The first one is focused on iOS. It installs a profile on an iOS device and then shows you once that profile is installed that you can sniff whatever the device is doing, like which applications is it running, what kind of websites is it going to. We also have a kind of mimicking of credential stealing in there, meaning that we're using Google search with an SSL interception in between, basically, which allows us to show on the attacking console anything you type into your Google search at that level. And we say, this is what credential stealing looks like, right? We have the same thing for Android. On Android, basically, you just go through a couple of steps, creates the access point. You connect the device you want to it, basically. And once that is done, let me quickly do that for you guys. Once that is done, it will bring you, connect here. It will bring you to, there we are. It will bring you, there we are. It will bring you to, you know, the attack scenario. Basically, in this case, it would say, okay, DNS spoofing is done, attack server is ready, and those kind of things. Once we install the APK on this Android device, it will allow me to, you know, get a picture from the device, so get access to the camera without the camera popping up, play a sound, record audio, get the SMS and call listing, get the context of the device. It's really a very simple but nice to show tool to again create the awareness, which still is kind of missing because most of people will not yet realize that they do have an issue on that side, right? I'm not going into detail because we can do a separate training to get you guys comfortable and installed with Zgit, so we can do a separate session on that one. Today's goal was really to make sure that you get up and running with the solution on one hand side, that you know that Zgit exists and that you can use it. And we wanted to conclude this session with, you know, in my opinion, the most spectacular one, which is what happens if a device is breached, right? Marcus is going to show that on a iOS device. Why? Because a lot of times there is the perception that iOS is more secure than Android, right? So if you can show an audience that it works on iOS, it's all over already a win on that one. And he'll walk you through the remainder of the presentations. Before I go away from the screen, I mean, I'm going to give our good friend Marcus already the rights to start sharing on his site. Any questions, Mehdi, before I conclude my part?
No, no question. I just put on the chat that we're gonna organize for the focused people who really need to go on Zgit deep and dive to know how to install it offline in another session. Everything is clear. I don't have any questions for you so far. Let's do the Zgit demo.
So this is Zcali. This is Zcali, what our good friend Marcus will be showing. This is something that we typically do because this is an exploit we're using now, which is still live, which is still exploitable, which is still undetected by our competition, which is also a plus, basically, which we run ourselves, right? Zkit is kind of the in-between that we give you. Zcali can be used for some use case if you want to go a little bit deeper. This specific use case, which we're showing you, that's why I absolutely wanted it to do it now. This one is only can only be done by Marcus or people within this Imperium team because of what I just told you, that it's still, you know, out there undetected by competition, and that we're still using it in POCs as well. So the goal of my part was, I hope you feel comfortable working, rolling out Singularity Mobile. I hope you're comfortable about the capability it has. There will be a big learning curve. The learning curve happens typically in front of real life projects, in front of real life questions you have while testing it. So feel free to bring all of that back to Luca and Mehdi, and they will tackle it in a very professional way. That's about it for me. Marcos, the floor is all yours, my friend.
Okay, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, I can show the image of the camera, but I prefer not to do it because I think that you will be seeing much bigger my demo environment. Okay, if you want to see my face, I can try to take a photo on the mobile device and maybe
get it
and have it. Okay, so if you want, okay. So thank you so much. I think we have 20 minutes left, so I'm going to try to stick to this time, even a little bit less, in case there is any kind of question that we need to answer. So what you can see right now is my screen. So I have a few windows, and you can see as well that there is a mobile device that is being shown by the camera. Okay, by the way, that is my daughter and another friend. Okay, so looks like I have to you know, that is better, so you can see more better, you know, the device. So you can see that they have a Sentinel-1 application installed. I installed it and activated it, like Gerrit showed it to you, so I don't want to take time to do it right now. And you can see on the thread log on the console, I have filtered it, you know, just to filter what is happening to this device. So if I go to the Sentinel-1 application, you can see that there is one risk detected. Okay, this risk is about showing me and alerting me that the version of the operating system is a certain one that should be updated. Okay, no more than that. It's the same alert you can see on the console, which is a vulnerable iOS version. Okay, no. This is something that I enable and activated yesterday afternoon, actually evening, when I was preparing for this demo. So if I switch in the console the filtering of the state and I clear, you will see that I have much more threats, okay? I have much more threats, mainly from yesterday afternoon when I was preparing the demo and setting everything up and checking that everything was working correctly, okay? All of them have been either approved or fixed, okay? And my intention is to reproduce this kind of events, this kind of threats, you know, live with you, okay? So let's filter this again and start the live demo. If you go to the device, let me come again to the Sentinel-1 application, and we go to network safety, okay? You can see that it is connected to a network, a Wi-Fi network, okay? The SSID of the network is Deco, okay? So the idea here is to show how this device is going to connect to a network that is known and familiar for the device, okay? So I will have to disconnect it from the Deco one. It is connected right now. And that network is a rock access point I'm going to create, and it's a fake point, to make the device connect to me, okay? I'm going to simulate. For doing that, I'm going to use what Gerd shared with you, what we call CKali, okay? This is my customized version of CKali. It's an internal tool we use to do life hacking demos, especially at the POC stage when are required, okay? We have several test cases. I'm not going to go over all the test cases. Just one to the test case 7. So as I said, this is my Linux box. It has the Wi-Fi dongle that Gerd showed to you connected, but it's not connected to any kind of Wi-Fi, okay? Because I'm going to use it to set up a rock access point, a fake access point where the device is going to connect. So let me start the attack and the demo. So I'm going to run the attack, okay? So first of thing, I'm suppose, or when an attacker wants to do an attack, usually choose a list of domains to act in the DNS, you know, to do a DNS spoofing. So I created a few ones, bbc.com, fnac.fr, or autogrill.com. So I'm not going to create any kind of new list, okay? I'm not going to add any new data to the list, okay? And I'm going to do is to create a Wi-Fi that I think is going to be familiar for the device. I can choose whatever I want, okay? I'm going to say yes. So it is suggested to me, like for instance, Starbucks, let me do one I think it could be familiar for you. Okay, I think if I'm not wrong, this is the Wi-Fi I is familiar for the device, okay? And it is right now starting the Wi-Fi, okay, and looking for possible connected clients, okay, in the two windows that you can see on the right part. So let me come back to the device, to the Wi-Fi side, okay, and I'm going to say that it should forget the current connection, okay, and let's go back to the Wi-Fi settings and let's see what other networks are around that the phone is able to see. Actually, it detected Autogrill Wi-Fi, so it is connecting actually to the Autogrill Wi-Fi automatically. So let's assume that I'm at an Autogrill and I'm trying to engage or get clients connected to my hacking environment while they don't know. So this is an unsecure network, so you know it is right now connected the device. Okay, let's come back, okay, and let's look at the terminal, and you can see that right now I have one client connected. The client is Marcos ISC, okay, and I right now have the IP address of this device, okay? So I'm not going to provide any kind of customer name. I try to customize this to Autogrill and let's see if it is customized, but I'm not going to provide that customer name. Let's say that I'm going to use the dongle, okay, WLAN 0, okay, and let's start the social engineering attack. So let me choose the IP address that we already know from the device because it is connected to our Wi-Fi, okay? So this is the IP address, the 90 is ending on the 90 number, okay? And I'm going to hit, okay? So as you can see, by the way, in the application Sentinel-1, I have, you know, actually more than one alert right now, okay? So you can see that it is saying that right now I'm connecting to a network that is not secure, okay? So just to let you know that we are getting, you know, more messages than we had at the beginning, okay? So right now my attack case is saying which OS you should choose. I'm going to choose the third option. I know the OS. There are other ways I can learn what is the OS that the device is using. In this case, is this, so I'm going to choose this, okay? But I'm not going to show how I can get that information, but it's something that we used to do in the POCS stage on the demonstration, how we can get such information from a device, okay? So I'm going to say 3, I'm going to launch the attack, and then as the device is connected to the network, okay, what I want to do is to do a social engineering attack. So let me open a browser and let's assume that the user goes to any of the DNS entries that I added at the beginning. So for instance, bbc.com, okay, and let's see what happens. Oh, this customized, well, perfect. So it's trying to go to any kind of place and it gets a message on the screen that we are putting using a man in the middle technique that you cannot see because maybe it is very small. What he's saying is, you know, we are in COVID time, so we detected that you are here. So for compliance reasons, you should download and install this application. to get your trace and so on, blah, 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 blah. So it is asking the user to click here and install an application, okay? So right now, what we are doing is to install a malware application. Actually, it's asking the user to install application and to start application, okay? So it is being used. And if you observe at the same time on the screen, you know, on the left-hand side, you know, the window I was using to launch the attack, it's saying it is connected, okay? So, wow, maybe we have access to the device. So let me come back here and say, and write so a few commands. So one of the first commands is help, because the help command allows me to see, you know, what other commands I have. For instance, maybe one funny command that we have here is the command save, that use the phone synthesizer to say whatever we want to say. So I'm going to say hello team, and as I would like to do this, maybe I can help me to sort not sorry not to war. Okay, this is a topic that is popular in these times. So let's see what happens when I do this, and I hope you can hear the phone saying this through my microphones. Let's see.
Hello team, help me to shout not to war.
Did you have the chance to hear that, even if it was slow? Can you confirm? Maybe or Kurt?
We did. Perfect.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so that is a funny command. Okay, we can manage the device actually. So it is good to know it. But we can do things like, for instance, contacts. So, and this is, you know, the download of the contacts that I have on the device. So if I look for contacts, okay, you will see that I have a lot of contacts. Even most of them, you know, are many times, like this one, Angel Barbero. Okay, so let's see, let's look at the last one, Amparo Oban. Let me look for it. Okay, so Oban, and you can see that Amparo Oban is there. Okay, what else can I do? I can also say call history. Okay, history. And also I can get the list of calls I got, okay, with the contacts. So as you can imagine, Carol is my wife, okay, is the people that I used to call more, okay. And what else can I do? Maybe if I use SMS, okay. Okay. Sorry, I think it is SMS. I can get also the messages that I have from the, you know, on the device. And well, from my daughter and so on. Okay, so these are funny things I can do, but there are other interesting things that I can do as well. For instance, let me show you here. I'm opening another window. This is the directory where I'm using the attack commands and so on. So here, that is what I have. Actually, if I come here, this directory is mounted on my device, on my laptop, which is on a laptop, you know, in Contest K7, I can see as well here, everything on site. So what can I do if I want as well? Let me show you. I can even record audio, okay? For instance, I have this command. So if I manage this device and the owner goes to a meeting, I can record what is happening on the meeting and get here as well. I'm not going to demonstrate this because we don't have enough time, but what I want to show you as well is that this device, okay, use you know, email, so I can go to my inbox. And as you can see, I have an email coming from myself, okay, from my business address, okay. And it has, I don't know if you can see it, it has an attachment, okay, here, okay. It's a document You cannot see it in big, but no worries. What I'm going to do right now is to show you how it is solved. So this is the same email account. This is the message I was selling to you, and this is the document I was showing to you. So one thing I can do as well, you know, in my live hacking demo is to download attachments that the email client has on the device, okay? So let me do this. This is the command, and you can see that it was able to download a file and it left the file in this place, okay? So if I come here and I this again, documents, you know, should be there. If I come here and I come here, document attachments, okay, you can see the document that is here, okay, but it has been modified today, okay, rewritten today. So let me open this document, okay. You can see the document right now on my screen, and I'm going to do a couple of things, okay. Let's make this bigger. Okay, let's make this bigger as well, okay, and let's write something here, okay, in a smaller letter, let's say, like, you should be more cautious, let's say in this way, cautious, okay. I don't know if it is correct, but you get the point. So let me save this document. Sorry, save this document. Okay, it is modified right now. I'm going to close this. Okay, let me show it here. Okay, it is already there. I'm going to make a copy. I'm going to put this copy here. I'm going to change the name. I'm going to change to Q report. Okay. Let's leave the document there. And what I want to show you right now is, what if I use this document and I send an email to someone else, okay, with this document attached, and I try to do something malicious, okay? But let's try to do it. So maybe I can do it. So let me do this, send mail, okay? No, sorry, before that, I have to put this file on the device. So let's put this file, put file Q results docs into Q results docs. Okay. So this is going to put the document locally on the device. So then I will be able to send it by email and attach it to the email. Okay. Okay. Let me put file Q results. Maybe I didn't. Q report, sorry. I didn't name it again. So this is put file. Oh, sorry. I got to start again the test case. Okay. Let me do it in a moment. Okay. Let me close the Wi-Fi and start everything. Sorry for this. Okay. So attack it. Okay. No. No. Let's change it. Auto grill. Wi-Fi. Okay, let's see that the device is connected to the Wi-Fi. Again. Okay. By the way, you can see that right now Sentinel-1 is, you know, alerting that the device has been compromised in the past. Okay, it is okay. So the device is connected as well, same IP. Let me come back to. Choose the right IP address, option 3, launch the attack. Okay, I'm connected again. So let's do put file queue. Let me check again the name, queue report, okay? Queue report docs 2/TMP/queue report. Docs, okay. So now the report is on the device. So right now I can try to send mail. Okay, so send mail. Just the command to, as I showed it to you before. Okay, I have, this is the account I have configured on the device. Okay, I have another account on Gmail, which is this one. The user is different. The name of the user is marcos.timperiod@gmail.com. So I'm going to send this email, I'm going to show with attachment to this account, okay? I will come back later to show you what is the result. So it should go to marcos.timperiod@gmail.com, okay? Subject, queue results. Okay, hi Marcos, please find attached a queue results share with the board in advance and keep it confidential, for instance, okay? Then I can say thank you. And for instance, okay, and then control D to finish, and then it is asking for the attachment, so I can say TMP. /queue report.docs. Sorry. Okay, queue report. I should add to that. I think everything is well. Okay. And the email should have been sent. Okay. By the way, you know that email client is configured on the Gmail application. So here, maybe you can see that I got the email. Let me choose the right account. Yes. Okay, here it is. So I have the email. Let's see if I can open the document. Okay, with the modifications I did, even if I come back to the, you know, to the email console. This is the email I sent. Okay. Aquí, and you can see that everything is going well. So as you can see, on the same time, you know, here I have a lot of notifications. Sentinel-1 has detected one or more system changes with indicator that it has been compromised. Okay, I have 9 logged issues regarding my device has been compromised, and if everything goes well, you know, I should have all of these alerts here in the console. Okay, system tampering, elevation of privileges, devil jailbroken, broken and rooted. And as Gert saw it, I have a very detailed and useful forensic information regarding where it has been done, what was the process list. So this is very useful for forensics in terms of understanding, once that device has been compromised, what can be what happening on the device, what other applications were open, and so on. Networks, status, location. Okay, it was my home, so this is very useful information. So from my side, Gerd and Mehdi, I had not planned to show more things. If you want and if they want, I can do more things, but I think we are, you know, running out of time. So that is what I wanted to show you, even a failure and how to recover of a failure during the attack. Okay, so that was not
perfect. The whole goal was to show that the threat is real, right? We know that we need to show that in the field as well. But the whole detail you get, if this kind of thing happens, what's the outcome for the end user, right? What's at risk? Well, what can you do? How can you circumvent what's in there? And then how can you detect and react to it with Singularity Mobile? I think that was the goal of today. So we'll conclude this way. I'm not sure, maybe, if you've seen any other questions popping up. Did you?
Yeah, there is no questions up right now. I think it's a good introduction for the Zcali. As you can see here, we have seen all the detection and all the details. Please, guys, let us know if you have any more clarification. You need more clarification or any question on this hacking demo. I don't see any question, Luca.
Yeah. I don't see the same. Let me just share once again that we will be really, really, really interested and happy to do another meeting with the Zimperium guys to exploit all the values behind Zkit, which I think really interesting for all of our channel partners. So from my hand, guys, I would say another thank you, because you shared 2 hours of value, which is incredible for us to be in partnership with such a team. Don't know what to add honestly here. We are running out of time. People is still here listening to us. So guys, let me switch in Italian for a second. Ora parlo agli attendees in una lingua più nostra. Noi saremo andati fuori tempo massimo, quindi se non ci sono domande a questo punto, chiedo a Mehdi se ha piacere di fare la chiusa finale e di salutarci. Ovviamente qualsiasi domanda mettetela in chat, mettetela nelle question, oppure ci risentiamo a stretto giro, direi nel giro di un paio di settimane, con l'obiettivo di fare una nuova sessione focalizzata su Zkit, su per rendervi autonomi. Il nostro obiettivo è fare in modo che il nostro canale sia autonomo nel gestire in maniera sapiente, in maniera efficiente questo tipo di tecnologia. Quindi sapete che il team esteso c'è, non capisco come mai continua a blinkare come se fossi ammalato, però...
C'è un'interferenza, okay. Però non fa...
Esattamente, c'è qualche interferenza, non capisco come mai. Grazie alla sessione full deep dive, sarebbe molto interessante, la faremo assolutamente, garanzia mia e di Mehdi. Guys, let me go back to English. Thank you once again, Mehdi, just for say hello to all the attendees before to close out the presentation.
Ok, grazie a tutti per l'ascolto. Ricordo che manderemo un pacchetto di informazioni col guide, questo è importantissimo, e poi Luca, facciamo in modo che le persone veramente interessate che vogliono una NFR license per uso interno per giocarci sopra, per installare la console, usare il Zkit, e chiaramente siamo sempre disponibili con Gert, me o Marcos. Mandate a me tramite Luca tutte le request, così federiamo una sola persona e non perdiamo nessun filo, ed è così. Grazie a tutti e concludiamo. Grazie a tutti.
Mehdi, una cosa, hai detto una cosa importantissima. Tutti i partner che hanno partecipato alla sessione sono eligible di Not For The Sale. Chiedete al vostro contatto in Exclusive Network se vi verrà data. Tenete Exclusive come punto di contatto e sappiate che tutti avete diritto a Not For The Sale e Zkit. Ragazzi, grazie ancora, grazie a tutti i partecipanti, grazie Exclusive, grazie Gar, grazie Mehdi e grazie Marco. Siete stati stupendi.